Okay, well, welcome. Welcome to the webinar participants. We're going to start. I know there are a couple other people who are going to be here. Usually we meet in a larger room, but it's a smaller, smaller gathering today, so this works well. So make sure, grab those of us in the room, any bagels or coffee. And Daniel is saying, LMC, if your city brings a city cup, we can exchange a city cup for one of the LMC cups. So.
Oh, I care business.
Yeah. Not the LMC cup.
There we go. So let's see. Do we have Brionté on the phone yet? Maybe not yet. Okay, we will be joined. Midway through by the engagement director of the ecosystem or EcoDistricts organization out in Portland. So fortunate to have Brionté here. Let's say a couple more people will be coming. I think we'll want to do introductions of us. And by the way, it's not the October workshop. So I was curiously putting this together. Obviously, it's quite November, it feels like November. So thank you all for making it here. These are in person, and those who are away in their offices at home. So I'm Philipp, Muessig. I work over at MPCA, and I co-direct the GreenStep Cities program with Abby Finnis at the Great Plains Institute. And I guess we should say, so those of you on the webinar, if you can mute yourselves, because we can hear a little bit of background noise. So, all right, good. So we're So that's me, Philipp. I'm the contact person along with Abby on the Concept Cities website. So why don't we just do introductions of people in the room, maybe we'll start in the front here.
Hi, everyone. My name is Cassandra Schuler. I'm the recycling coordinator for the cities of West St. Paul, South St. Paul, Mendota Heights, and Sunfish Lake.
Sunfish, okay. All right, great.
I'm Joe Strommen. I'm a member of the Sustainability Commission for the City of Bloomington.
I'm Danielle Cabot. I'm on League of Minnesota City staff and in communications. Say hi.
Oh, hi. I'm Bill Barton. I'm running the webinar.
Great. Thank you.
Alex Kohlhoff. I'm the zoning administrator from the City of Stillwater.
John Cramplin from the Isaac Walton League, Minnesota Division. We're one of the sponsors of GreenStep Cities.
I'm Kevin Bright. I'm the Energy and Sustainability Director for the City of Rochester and the Destination Medical Center Project.
Good morning. I'm Tara Brown with the City of Edina.
Sean Finwell, City of Maplewood, Environmental Planner.
Good. Well, so the impetus for this workshop, and so we, as you see, we have three people from cities to share perspectives on what is the new program, protocol, sort of structured thinking about district level economic development. The impetus was the EcoDistricts organization, one of whose directors, Tom Osdeba, I used to work with. He worked over at the what was the old office? Minnesota Office of Environmental Assistance. Tom's now in, I think, in London doing work, district level work. But so Tom and I have talked over the last few years, and we knew that the EcoDistricts organization has a 2-day workshop which travels to different cities around the country, and we were fortunate to, for EcoDistricts to pick Minneapolis for that 2-day conference, which was in mid-October. So. And we know, good morning, Ellen. So we know there were, easily a dozen Minnesota people from Minnesota cities working at various roles with the cities who attended the conference. There were maybe, 150 people at the conference? I'm thinking, the McNamara Center at the University, that large room. It was a 2-day conference. I guess having sort of looked at the over the last 3 years, the evolution of the EcoDistricts protocol, and then looking at the organization and then being at the conference, it just really confirmed my thought that it's a useful framework to discuss, and most importantly for some GreenStep City representatives to reflect on, of the many other sort of structures, frameworks,
certification systems, checklists, you know, how does this, you know, is this an empowering, is this a good structure? So, so I want to make some preparatory remarks. Brionté will come on the phone, thinking, and also sort of augment my comments. So with that, do I have a clicker?
Yeah.
All right.
So advance. Pointer.
Cool. Okay. All right. So, but first, and click. As we work out the technology,
is it on?
Is it on? Maybe it's supposed to have a little writing. So we thank the league. It seems like every year we've done these workshops. Maybe we've done these workshops for 5 years? Yeah. Technology has evolved. It feels like there are always little glitches, but last month was perfect. Okay, so we're still working on the clicker. Or I can just, oh, there, well, I saw the clicker earlier, the pointer there. Yeah, maybe I can just. All right, hold on there. We're okay. Where is that? Yeah, if it's on, you send it synced. Let's see. Well, while we're I'm waiting. So, Allie,
you
want to introduce yourself?
Yeah. My name's Allie. I work for the City of Inver Grove Heights, and I'm the environmental specialist.
Thanks. All right, we're still working on the point. But first, I wanted to, since we're going to go through just this one dozen slides here, I wanted to point out that next month, which is December, first Wednesday, we will be talking about the GreenStep Step 4, 5 metrics. So in the GreenStep program, as I think you all know, we've sort of done the final build out of the program. So at Step 1, cities join, as you know. Step 2 and 3, you report text on how you've completed various perspectives actions. Step 4 and 5 is reporting metrics, so numbers, and then showing improvement in numbers. And we're going to make a change this year, which I think is going to be really, really helpful. It's also an interesting set of tools that cities might find useful. Instead of cities completing a spreadsheet that we've been doing, this sort of clunky, you send a spreadsheet, we post it on your GreenStep Cities page. We take a look at each spreadsheet and add things up and try to do some comparisons. We will be gathering your step four numbers via a survey. So a snap survey is a flexible web-based survey you log on to. You can save it, come back later, send it to other staff members. So we're going to gather the numbers from it'll probably open up January 1st or mid-January through May 1st, which is when GreenStep metrics are due. So we'll gather the numbers through this snap survey, pretty common, cheap license, and then we will grab the data using a Tableau server, Tableau software. And Tableau is this just fabulous way to sort of slice, dice, and graphically display information. So we're beginning to see enough information from 15 cities that have sent in metrics last year. We're getting enough data that it's going to really be lovely to have this Tableau online feature so that any one of us can click and say, you know, how does energy use Edina compared to Marshall, or what's the walk score in Duluth as composed to Rochester, or miles of sidewalk paths reconstructed in the last year, or how was it over the last 3 years, or averages. So it's going to be a fun workshop, and we'll be using or be having the PCA staff people who have graciously jumped in to do this. So that's okay. So it looks like it. Yeah, all right, so that's next month, and I just wanted to, encourage people to, and it'll be an easy one to log on the webinar, because we'll be just going through how to use the SNAP survey and what Tableau can do. So the content of the meeting. So here, as you can probably remember, of the 29 best practices on GreenStep, we have, and we did this in 2009, we, a small group of us taking direction from a large set of, well, there were five working groups, and there was an advisory committee that the League of Minnesota Cities pulled together. So in 2009, we tried to affix sort of what is the major sort of benefit for each of the 29 best practices. I can see how this does. Yeah, so here are our cute little images. And we were very much thinking about survey research we had done in, it was probably 1995 with Tom Horner and Tim Penny, Emily Horner Research Group. We asked the question across Minnesota. We had phone surveys, small group. We asked the question of sort of how does what was then in 1995 a sort of the emerging concept of sustainability. We asked the question sort of, you know, how does this resonate in communities? What came back very strongly was sort of leverage interests, so education, not surprisingly, but sort of talk about the benefits. You know, what are the benefits here? Don't talk about the ideology. Make this a sort of a voluntary partnership between government, business, people, nonprofits. So here are sort of major benefits. And community shows up in three of these. So community self-reliance, community quality, community health. And myself, having worked for a neighborhood association for 8 years, having worked with organizing food cooperatives for 10 years, and having done this sort of sustainability education work for 10 years, it did feel like sort of the community part was pretty obvious. But in being sort of housed at the Minnesota Pollution, then it was the Office of Environmental Assistance, GreenStep is, you know, it has a focus on sort of environmental sustainability. So those social elements of sort of, you know, issues of sort of wealth, health, public safety, those more pure sort of social dimensions of sustainability don't have a large footprint in the GreenStep actions. I think that, well, it is growing when we are sort of leading things in, but it feels like, and EcoDistricts, I think, does this so well, to really look at a very sort of people first, grassroots sort of local knowledge sort of element for economic development. And so the EcoDistricts in Brionté, hopefully will jump in.
She is on the line.
Oh, she is. Okay. Hi, Brionté. That's good. Well, I think Brionté will get to
Hello.
Pretty quickly. We'll get to this last slide, which will be the EcoDistrict protocol icon image, and then you can make comments and corrections, amendments. So in GreenStep, you know, we're talking about city actions that are shaping public and private actions, and we certainly in the 1990s we have certification systems, for example, for buildings, so green buildings, but and we have sort of city level actions, but this sort of neighborhood scale, district level scale, I would say since 2009, when the GreenStep best practices were formed, we've been wanting to sort of emphasize it. So I think EcoDistricts does a good job at that. So here's sort of a few sort of summary sort of thoughts here. We're talking neighborhood scale, so we're talking, can be 5 acres, a neighborhood that's within a 10-minute walk is about 160 acres. The Ford assembly plant being redone, which was on the tour of the EcoDistrict Conference, is 150 acres. So we're talking at that scale. We're talking not just building, not just site, but buildings and sites, streets, public, private. EcoDistrict is very clear about high performance. It's very clear about private sector action. So this is an economic development structure. And I think it does a really, really good job of putting sort of people first and sort of local sort of knowledge, sort of equity focused community development into physical development with these high standards of carbon zero, carbon neutrality by 2030. So the architecture 2030 platform, which the state of Minnesota uses for, in Minnesota we call it SB 2030, Sustainable Buildings 2030. So if any of your cities receive bond money, you need to hire an architect who will build a building increasingly moving toward carbon neutrality. So by 2030, any of those state funds would need to result in a building that gets launched on the SB 2030 case study website as a carbon neutral building. So we have high standards if we're spending state money. And EcoDistricts is very clear about why not high standards. Certainly when the city is involved, and EcoDistricts is very much about a collaborative process where city, people who live in a district area, private sector, nonprofits are in fact working toward these high performance. We're talking obviously things like solar and storage for resiliency, for peak shaving, the economic benefits. This phrase, shared stacked green infrastructure, which I'll come back to, came up on numerous occasions. We have an example in the Allianz site that we visited. And we're probably talking about bigger capital costs, but distinctly lower operating costs, which is very much a thing for GreenStep cities. So Best Practice 28 on the GreenStep cities website was focused on eco-industrial development. So I'll show you a little bit of history of that in Minnesota. Very challenging. We just have a few sort of pure examples. And so this best practice, we have morphed. And so action number four, we challenge cities to use the EcoDistrict tools and EcoDistrict protocol. So here's where you would find a link to the EcoDistrict's website. You can just fill out your name, email a few little details, and download for free the EcoDistrict's protocol. I have a copy, Alex, I can. So I printed out the five, I think it's seven pages here of the key indicators. And you can do that, as I say, from the links on the GreenStep website. So as I was saying, so we, you know, there are, I think, cities in a way, you're confronted with various sort of certification programs, checklists, sort of indicators. So there's, I sort of list a few, a few here. And each of these, I think, to various extents, does a good job of thinking about the maybe two of the sort of three elements of sustainability, if you will. So green building certainly does very typically, I mean, not to overgeneralize, but I think green building, like LEED for new buildings, new construction, does a good job at sort of the economic and environmental dimensions. The equitable development scorecard, again, these are, you can find them all through GreenStep. That's part of the point of the GreenStep program, is that you can sort of find and sort of choose a system that resonates and works for you. The equitable development scorecard developed in by the Harrison Neighborhood and the Alliance for Metro Stability, I think does a very good job of looking at sort of environmental social dimensions. I'll say a few words about eco-industrial development, as I said, and there's LEED for neighborhood development, came out of the Congress for the New Urbanism, Doug Flower in Chicago. I'm just a top flight designer of carbon neutral buildings, LEED Platinum buildings. The last 10 years has been a major. He has a great book, Urban Design with Nature. So there's lots out there. And going ahead. I think the EcoDistrict protocol, which is based in picking indicators and working toward indicators. Okay, so here, yeah, all right, so. I think the EcoDistrict protocol is a, feels to me sort of conceptually, intellectually as a very good one, largely because it's such a it has such a great focus on the sort of people side. So just a few comments. So here's here's an image that Doug grabbed in his book, and this is the sort of the thinking of, you know, what is a, in this case, 160 acres, you know, what is a sustainable neighborhood, a complete compact, connected community neighborhood look like. And Lead for Neighborhood Development is on the GreenStep City's website. We have one development, the Excelsior and Grand development, that has certified. And Excelsior and Grand is in, is that in St. Louis Park?
It's St. Louis Park.
St. Louis Park. Okay. So, so we have one development in Minnesota. We have a neighborhood just south of downtown, southwest of downtown Minneapolis. We have a neighborhood that is used Lead for Neighborhood Development, that system of credits. The Ford side, actually, there was a grad student who sort of used Lead for Neighborhood Development very early on, 2011 or 2010, I think it was. And that sort of Lead ND sort of analysis of how might the Ford side develop has been used. So Lead ND is great, but we have very few people using it. District development, where you're looking at conscious sort of shared sort of energy and material flows, you're looking at maximizing sort of byproducts to create other products to sell them, has a internationally certainly a big footprint in Sweden, the Kolmogorv Industrial Park, been written about for probably 20 years. In Minnesota, Silver Bay and Victus Farms, which is a greenhouse, has sort of a complex industrial ecology, and this is certainly district level work. EcoDistricts doesn't talk much, maybe Brionté can touch on this, doesn't touch on this, but EcoDistrict development, as we see in Silver Bay, has a sort of long, again, sort of economic backing. A lot of work has been done in Minnesota, attempts, so this was work in St. Peter. So you can see in the sort of flow chart of, again, we're talking about really energy and materials and in a district setting where usually independent businesses are linking and working together. It's pretty sophisticated. Here, four other plans, some of which, for example, in Duluth Superior, extensively worked out design charrettes. So the work is extensive. It's district level work. It's going beyond an individual development project. So, you know, one building here, another building here, a set of human services or ecological services. It's looking very consciously at working at that district level, which of course is complex. It's easier just to build a lead building, right? The eco-industrial development people have definitely tried to push this further. I think the eco-district people have done, and I think I felt at the conference really showed again this sort of this very people-centered process. So what was, I think, one notable thing for me is that the EcoDistricts board and at the conference was distinctly, you know, more younger people, more people of color, more women, although I think in the sustainability field we do tend to see more women than, for example, when I go to affordable housing or classic economic development groups, you know, it tends to be more older men, white men. I think EcoDistricts, again, in starting with their board, their staff, and then who came to the conference, I think showed, again, sort of that richness power. So at the conference, we had several afternoon trips that we took, and a few of these, I'll just point out the Ford site, again, 150 acres, major theme of bringing back to the surface water, which is now in a basically a north-south concrete channel underneath the site, will be sort of brought to life. And that's a organizing theme that was way back in 2010. Actually, we funded, the PCA funded some of that early work. Indicators like the EcoDistrict Protocol, the port site work here in 2011, working with the Minnesota Design Center at the U of M, crafted metrics in these 11 or so categories. Sort of what do we want to see and how that's actually worked out, and how Ryan Company's now the owner of the parcel, how that works out is going to be very interesting. I have not followed it that carefully, but the early work was definitely influenced by sort of broad indicators-based design work and looking at this major theme of water. Rochester, Kevin is here from Rochester, so you can, when you get a chance, Kevin, say more, but the Destination Medical Center, district level work, obviously very much with a theme of medical services, medical technology, and guidelines developed in these three categories. Other Twin City projects that were featured at the EcoDistricts conference here, the old Twin Cities Army Ammunition Plant, yeah, TCAP, now Rice Creek Commons, a mixed-use development, up in Arden Hills, we didn't take a trip there. I think someone at the conference spoke about it. I know I've been talking with one of the city council members. I think Arden Hills is in some like conflict with the county, so, but that's a project, a district level project. Again, very challenging, but very, very high aspirations. Allianz Field we traveled to, I would say a major theme we saw there was the sensible cost saving, but sort of a bureaucratically complex system of getting separate entities to work together on a shared stormwater system. So rather than as we have in conventional subdivision design, rather than every parcel of land and every owner having to be responsible for or report back to separate stormwater management rules and outcomes, Allianz Field is working with all the parcel owners in the sort of district, the Allianz districts, which is beyond just the footprint of the soccer field. So we learned a little bit that there's a cistern there. So again, that complex work, which is not, there's no city money in the Allianz project. There probably is the watershed district. So I think we all have found in doing district work, watershed districts, because naturally they go beyond individual parcel level or even beyond individual city boundaries, working with watershed districts that, or WMOs that have levy authority, obviously a way to pay for these more challenging things. Other projects that were visited, Rondo is this sort of aspirational Boston big concept of basically putting a lid over part of Interstate 94 that went through an old mixed-use, old strong neighborhood development, African American Center development. The Towerside Innovation District and Motley are basically to the sort of east of the University Minneapolis campus of the University of Minnesota. Motley is I'd say the theme there certainly is university research, but the Motley district is majority ownership of various arms, tentacles of the University of Minnesota. So that's a district where, again, the animating theme, the catalyst is ownership. So parcel development is not as complex. Towerside is up by the Surly Brewery, by the railroad tracks.
Where's Motley neighborhood?
Motley neighborhood, apparently it was a neighborhood 50, 75 years ago. It's, I suppose it's centered around where University and Washington Avenues meet, sort of by the Green Line LRT stop, you know, the sort of the curve Green elevators. I'm trying to think what else would be Oaken, or is it Oaken?
I think they call it Stadium Village.
Yes.
And the green line.
Yeah, it's a parcel. I forget how many acres. Maybe it's smaller.
I Googled it. It says the Motley area of Prospect Park makes up the western edge of Prospect Park,
western,
south of Southeast Washington Avenue, where the neighborhood blends into the University of Minnesota. Does that help?
So it's further, okay. Tower Side, the tower in Prospect Park, these two districts are, I think the fact that the University of Minnesota Foundation, but also the Neighborhood Association there are, and the business, obviously, Strong Business Association are, it's just not development as usual. It's not your classic sort of land assembly by the city or a project being proposed by a developer, an economic developer. It's a more complex development that really has this higher aspiration.
Philip, the Tower Side Innovation District
is
the only one that's EcoDistricts certified. So they got the certification from the nonprofit.
They did. Thank you. Okay, good. I didn't go on that. On that tour, but that was one of the tours. So great. So right. I think Upper Harbor Terminal, which is at the west side of the river in Minneapolis, and the Glenwood Plymouth Corridor, Old Industrial Corridor, are two sort of emerging, again, district level projects. So let's see. So I think before jumping to and maybe a perfect place for Brionté to jump in and make comments, before looking at the actual protocol, and really the point here today is not so much to say go out, sign up your project for the protocol. It's more look at the protocol, see how it can fit or shape your thinking about economic development, this strong people-centered economic development. But we want to say some comments about the protocol because it is in its sort of implementation as a project gets registered and then works through the process and development. The protocol, challenges us all to measure, to pick what we're going to measure. So among a menu of indicators, pick what you want to measure, what do you care about, and then measure. So obviously, the literature of sustainable development is so rich with, we need to measure what matters, and what matters we need to measure. And EcoDistrict protocol jumps to that. And that's what's in the handout, is the a list of sort of options for indicators that a project would pick and measure. So we're talking about sort of equitable, resilient neighborhoods for the people who live there. So this phrase, welcoming cities of belonging versus becoming, stuck in my mind. I think it's in sort of older sort of classic economic development, or certainly if you go back in the 1950s and sort of like, urban redevelopment, it's like, we have a problem here. We're going to sort of come in and spend money via the private developer or the city, and we're going to sort of clean up this area, and it's going to become a better place. EcoDistricts is very much about who's there now, what do they know, what's the history. Motley is interesting because it was the Motley neighborhood. People identified with the Motley neighborhood, and I think the University Foundation leading that work is thinking, well, it was a neighborhood, why can't it not be a neighborhood where people have that sort of affinity, the face-to-face interactions, business people and residents know each other. So a welcoming city or district, really, of where people belong, and know something stuck out of my mind. Certainly housing, affordable housing, NOAA, naturally occurring affordable housing, was discussed at the conference. The person, Gretchen, from the local LISC, it's affordable housing, it's a national affordable housing funder. What does it stand for, LISC? I'm blanking.
Low income sustainability.
LISC is Local Initiative Support Corporation. There we go. Okay, so Gretchen from LISC especially in looking at the Towerside and Motley development, was thinking of district level projects around the country that have looked at health systems, health insurers who sort of look at sort of the cost imposed by homeless people, marginally employed people, people with chronic illness. There has been funding from health systems for some district level work as a way of actually, it's just a cost positive intervention, a way for health. And I don't know, maybe Kevin can speak a little bit about involvement, obviously, of Mayo Clinic in the district work there. We talked about, obviously, privately owned public spaces there. Again, we talked about sort of the richness and really sort of thinking about sort of a district where people are engaged, collaborative, the work is benefiting people who are there now and people to come. We talked about Architecture 2030 and those goals. And if for nothing else, just designing sort of a better product in terms of the physical environment that can withstand everything from climate shocks, price shocks, sort of changing demographies. And then we talked about the sort of district work, and I'll be interested to hear comments from city people about what is, you know, what's the range of possible things like a development where two separate entities are sharing a parking lot. I mean, even something that simple, I know can be extremely difficult, especially if each development parcel is being sold off on the secondary market. Secondary market, you know, hates to package products that have shared parking. Example, so shared parking makes so much, or district level parking makes so much sense. We know that, but it's challenging to do sort of organizationally, financially. But again, that's sort of the high aspiration in the sense, I think, of the ecodistrict thinking. So we and talked about district stormwater. And again, thinking about what we do in our streets, parks, underground, as in Allianz Field, or for small rainfall events, having green roofs, which also cut energy use for buildings. So parking, district heating, cooling, combined heat and power projects were probably, combined heat and power projects, especially in northern Minnesota, were probably more common in 1950 than they are now, but we're beginning to see, certainly the expansion a few years back in St. Paul to district cooling. We're certainly seeing more district work, so maybe Rochester we can again hear something about that. And then, you know, businesses, you know, business improvement districts called by different names, where you have business owners collectively deciding to tax themselves, feed themselves to provide extra benefits. You know, that district level work is very common. We see that certainly larger cities, we see that around downtown Minneapolis has a bid. But that sort of thinking, again, it's not simple, it's not easy. The benefits, I think, are tremendous if done well. Coming up, what came up several places during the two-day conference was just what's the property tax take per acre in the district now? We certainly need to increase it because cities, unless you're annexing, cities have a boundary. You've got that land, and if you have increasing services, how are you paying for it? If there's not a housing or commercial intensification that's leading to or density intensification that's leading to greater property taxes per acre, like how is the city funding itself and funding obviously aging infrastructure? So those were just some thoughts. So this is the last slide here, and it's okay, so it's 20 to 10. So the protocol, and then we'll have Brionté make some comments. It starts, the green on the outside here is helping us think about three phases for implementation. The orange, we have priority indicators, and this is in the handout. And then the teal in the middle here, so what are those imperatives? And we're talking climate, equity, and resilience. And that, I mean, everyone had to sort of have a soundbite for EcoDistricts. It's that we're looking at sort of these, you know, pressing issues of climate change, of equity, and sort of cultural inclusion, and then resilience to all kinds of shocks. So that's those are my comments. And again, we'll have a chance. We'll have people from a few cities talk and present. But maybe I'll just jump and say, Brionté, do you want to jump on?
Sure. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yeah, that's good.
Wonderful. And I apologize in advance. I'm a little ill, so my voice might start sounding scratchy, and, you know, just bear with me. So I think you've done a great job so far talking about the importance of district scale, neighborhood and district scale development, why we want to approach it at a neighborhood and district scale, and sort of what some of those projects are in Minneapolis and St. Paul. And I really had a great time organizing the conference in the Twin Cities and getting to know the people involved in the projects, and bringing everyone together so that they can collectively share, you know, ideas and connections on how they're moving the projects forward. And one of the main comments we got after the summit was these projects that had all been happening simultaneously that were neighborhood and district scale had no idea about the other projects, and it just, you know, nobody had been thinking that, oh, there's this cohort of people in Minneapolis and St. Paul kind of all struggling and wrestling with making really big strides in sustainability and equity at these scales, and there was a lot of benefit in them being able to see and talk to each other and build relationships. So we were happy to facilitate some new connections and partnerships to make those things happen. So I want to reemphasize, you know, the importance of the district scale. Phil gave you a lot of context on that, but it's the neighborhood. What he was saying was that, you know, you've got all these different things happening typically in a neighborhood simultaneously. We're living in a time where everyone's moving into, you know, back into the city. We're seeing this trend, people flowing back in, and sort of an unprecedented amount of investment going into revitalizing neighborhoods, some of which are empty and abandoned, some of which still have plenty of people who want to be involved and be a part of that revitalization. Of course, this is a really critical time as we're talking about climate, and we're recognizing that, you know, we've not made the amount of progress we need to really prevent a lot of those climate changes from happening. And so now we're talking about resilience and how we're going to be prepared for all of that. And it's obviously the resilience conversation has opened the door to thinking more beyond just the environment, the built environment, and starting to add in this extra layer of what's going on socially in the city and how can that impact a city's ability to thrive in different situations. And so all these different things are happening. We're seeing, you know, buildings being transformed. We've got all of these social initiatives coming down the pipeline. And in a different neighborhood, all of these things happening have this tremendous cumulative impact on the long-term shape and outcome of that particular neighborhood. And the notices, if there's no entity, no management process, nobody really looking at those cumulative impacts, identifying, you know, what's missing, how can things be strengthened, or are people even achieving the goals that they set out to achieve? How do you not duplicate efforts or cannibalize each other when you're trying to implement all of these different things? It gets kind of overwhelming, and we've seen it happen in different parts around the country where, you know, all this change sort of happens to a neighborhood very quickly, and it the fundamental character of the neighborhood changes, and it's not always good, it's not always positive. And so just in response to sort of this frustration of people who are, you know, involved in different projects that are starting to be, you know, bigger scale, people are approaching things as, you know, not just a couple of neighborhoods anymore. Now it's, you know, people are looking at these really large acreage projects, and they're realizing that they've got to find a way to manage all of this. And so what we've done at EcoDistricts is done a lot of studies on some of the neighborhoods in this country that are thriving, that have been thriving, and we're taking lessons learned and best practices from those case studies and working with partners like NeighborWorks and LISC and PolicyLink to really identify like what's worked well and what hasn't, and really concentrating that in on the neighborhood scale, because the neighborhood is small enough for us to try new approaches, for us to measure things in a way that's much more comprehensive, and to adjust and tweak and also share those lessons back out in a way that's incredibly scalable. It's hard to apply a lesson from one city, you know, to another city, just, you know, equally. But if you've got something, a smaller unit like a neighborhood, it's a little bit more transferable and scalable. And so the EcoDistricts protocol is really focused on maximizing outcomes in climate, equity, and resilience at the neighborhood and district scale. And so, you know, before I get too far down the road, I really want to emphasize those three things: climate, resilience, and equity. We think it's critical that when people are approaching urban redevelopment projects, that they are committed to those three things up front. Typically, there's a lot of stated commitments. Cities have initiatives that they're passing, saying they're committed to climate and resilience. And there's an increasing conversation about equity and how to really move beyond rhetoric and move into policy and practice. And so lots of cities are passing different resolutions and things like that. In Minneapolis, what we saw was the green zones legislation. So that was a resolution the city council passed. And they're saying, hey, we're committed to, you know, looking at areas that not only have been, you know, environmentally devastated, but also have all of these incredible racial disparities that we want to make sure that we're committed to investing in. So we're seeing that trend across the country where people are sort of stating these commitments to equity and climate and, of course, resilience. There's a big resilience movement right now in all cities. So we think that those three things have to be in the works before people can sort of move forward with implementing the protocol and again making sure they're maximizing on all those outcomes. So once people we know that there's this feel or this need to pursue progress in those areas, we work on formation. And so formation is a really key part of what we do. Formation is really about collaborative governance. It's about who's at the table and how they're sharing power in decision making to sort of manage these big projects that have lots of different stakeholders and lots of different players. What's the governance model for that? So often we approach development and we don't have that piece figured out, and you've got all of these groups involved, and it gets really messy really quickly. And so we try to take care of that up front by having a very candid discussion about what our formation looks like. What is our governance model? How are we managing these projects? How are we coming together to manage these different goals and commitments that we've made in these different areas? And we're making sure that those things are being done, and we're able to strengthen where we're not doing so well or not performing. So in lots of different places, we've got 15 EcoDistricts projects across the nation, and collaborative governance models all look different because there's different stakeholders in every neighborhood. But what's key is that you've got typically city leadership, some county leadership, neighborhood leadership. You've got a development team. The development team is involved and bought into this. You have community groups, whether that be neighborhood associations or, you know, nonprofits, or just a set of dedicated community leaders. But we bring everybody to a table and talk very candidly and work out a governance model that allows for equal representation and inclusion in the decision making. And once you've got sort of that collaborative governance model figured out, then we really drill down into what we call road mapping. And in road mapping, what we're doing is we're building a comprehensive performance-based investment action plan around six priorities. And so our priority indicators, as you can see in this graphic, are place, prosperity, connectivity, health and well-being, living infrastructure, resource regeneration. So we think about all of these things, and The way that our protocol is structured, we have exercises and different tools that people can use to think about all of these things and really flesh out what their strategy looks like in each area. And to Phil's point earlier, we're not being prescriptive in any way by saying that you've got to do these things to in creative placemaking, and you've got to do these things to facilitate prosperity. What we do is we allow the table of people who come together and form that collaborative governance model to grapple with these questions of what prosperity looks like, what does connectivity look like, how do we really maximize on health and well-being. And so it becomes this really customized process where you're looking at all of these different areas, but of course, some people lean in more heavily into other areas depending on their context and what's needed. We've got a group, for example, in Seattle, the Capitol Hill Eco District, and this is a community, predominantly community of color, and they are in a part of town that was formerly redlined, so that, you know, they're lots of housing practices, land ownership practices that prevented people of color from, you know, buying property and building wealth in that way. And so what was interesting about that was the city had passed this legislation that got them 1% sales tax for arts. And so they awarded this particular neighborhood $150,000 to do creative placemaking. So by taking that money, and before they just decided to just, you know, go hire some artists and do some murals and put some nice park benches and things down, what they did was they looked at that money and they looked at that potential investment through the EcoDistricts protocol and decided that they wanted to leverage it as much as possible to maximize on prosperity, because that was something that they were particularly mindful of and concerned about. And so they developed an investment strategy for those funds that really made sure that it was a lot more intersectional. The investment ended up supporting artists directly through funding, but also they expanded the definition of artists into different tradesmen, people who build people who do contracting, sort of, you know, woodwork, or people who do you know, more artisan kind of work with metal. And so it became you know, more building focused in a way that I don't think the people who originally envisioned the grant had thought of. And so I'm trying to be really concise here. There's a lot to dig into in that particular example. But what the point is that they took this money that could have just been used for, you know, traditional kind of arts and culture and placemaking. By taking it through the protocol and looking at these different priorities, they were able to find a way to use that money to meet multiple priorities. So that is the benefit of sort of taking the EcoDistricts approach, is you're looking at things more comprehensively, and you're looking at the connections in between investments and seeing how they can serve multiple goals and strategies. So that is part of our road mapping process. And like I said, we're just trying to develop this comprehensive performance-based investment action plan. And in that process, we move on to performance, where we're looking at being really clear about the metrics that we're looking at, so that we can have transparent and rigorous reporting that we can constantly revisit to see where our strategies aren't being maximized on and where they need to be strengthened, or where new partners need to be brought in to make it more effective. So that's basically the EcoDistricts protocol. So I kind of talked about implementation as I was talking about indicators and priorities. But the outcome is that you end up with this very measurable sort of tool where you can go into a neighborhood and kind of stand there and look at all of the different ways that your investments are actually meeting these priorities. And you can measure that. So if you've got a goal, for example, around reducing energy consumption in an area, through the EcoDistricts protocol, you've identified a bunch of different strategies to get there and identified some tactics to get there, but then also made it clear how you're going to measure that. So you could theoretically stand in the neighborhood and point at different solar panels and different systems that you've put into place that are actually serving to meet that metric. And so it becomes a really visual and tangible tool for neighborhoods to make sure that they are really making the progress that they have stated that they want to make on sustainability and equity. And the protocol is a very clear way to develop those strategies and to manage it, where we didn't necessarily have a way to manage all of these different priorities in these vastly different areas in a comprehensive way before. So, you know, we do have a certification. We have, like I said, 15 projects across the nation that are pursuing EcoDistrict certified. But rather, again, rather than it being sort of a prescriptive checklist of things you need to do to get points so that you can get a certain level of recognition, you know, it's a lot more tangible in that it's a tool that you can use to manage all of these things. And so it's less focused, like I said, on a checklist and a lot more focused on giving you a process that you can follow and customize. But it makes things a lot more clear. So I feel like I could probably ramble a little bit more about that, but is that clear to people? Do people have questions about that?
Could you explain the difference between LEED neighborhood and the Eco District?
I think I would summarize it as LEED is a certification like the Eco District's protocol. LEED is more prescriptive. They're sort of minimum requirements that you have to meet, and then they're like LEED for buildings. They're X number of, I forget if it's points or just number of areas that you need to hit. Right. But I would say, perhaps you can fill in better, but I would say that the protocol is a much better acknowledgement that there's process involved in doing anything as complicated as district level work, as opposed to a building. And so, yeah, LEED for neighborhood development or site, you know, if you're a landscape architect, sites, or if you're a public works director in vision, I mean, there are these other, more like checklists. I would say the protocol is more process oriented. I think it sets higher aspirations, but it gives more flexibility. But,
how would you? I would say that's exactly it. You know, I think LEED is an awesome program. And when I started my career, obviously LEED was sort of the main rating system people were looking at, and then ND came out. And it, you know, again, it's a lot more prescriptive. It's a lot more like this is sort of the checklist of things that you need to do to achieve a certain rating level. And it's not necessarily giving people a way to clarify what they're committing to, or really, flesh out a vision and then identify the stakeholders that should be involved and sort of manage that from start to finish. It's a lot more like, here are things that you need to meet, and then we'll give you this certain level certification. We're, as Phil said, we're a lot more process oriented. We know that even if you want to become a LEED ND and you want to hit all of those checklists, there's a lot of stuff involved and getting to a place where you can deliver on those things. And again, the biggest piece being, who are the different stakeholders involved? Are they all really committed to achieving the same vision around climate, around equity, and around resilience? So we have a very stated, and it's embedded in every piece of our process, that equity is front and center. So we're a lot more explicit about that. And so getting that commitment, figuring out that vision, developing the roadmap with the right set of stakeholders. Like, again, so that's really what we're focused on, is that process, rather than, you know, again, you just have to do these things to get these points to achieve a certain level. So theoretically, you'll still get, you know, all of the savings that you would if you followed LEED ND. And of course, these aren't mutually exclusive. You can be EcoDistrict certified and also be pursuing LEED ND. So you'll still get the savings in terms of sustainability, but you're going to be looking at things and have a very different model in terms of how you're approaching the development based on the way that you've assembled your group of stakeholders to manage and guide and measure the process. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Good, thank you. Other questions or initial comments before we hear from three cities here? Okay, well, great. Thank you, Brionté.
Yeah.
So I thought we'd have comments from Tara.
Do you want me to head up there? Can I just talk?
You can just talk, I think, yeah.
So we were fortunate to, with the EcoDistricts Conference, Edina was fortunate enough to send one of our planners, Emily, and she's online, as well as I was only able to attend a day, so our affordable housing coordinator attended the first day, and then I attended the second day. And some of the thoughts that she had, it was really important to me to bring some of my partners, because they are the people that really work on the planning and the development. So I think it's really important for them to hear all of this information so they're armed with it. My affordable housing coordinator, my colleague, said it just reiterated for her the national awareness and diving deeper between the environmental sustainability and the racial economic justice that needs to happen. Gave her some information around how communities of color are disproportionately live in MRE polluted areas and how this affects birth outcomes and school successes. And a real need for community engagement with an iterative process. I think we all have community engagement processes, but how do we make those more iterative, which is a thing that I saw too. And with her job in particular, really figuring out how to demystify Section 8 residents, because there's a thought that those that need Section 8 housing, there might be something wrong, or they're going to bring something to the neighborhood that isn't there currently. And so how do we demystify and help people see those that need Section 8 are just people that are trying to do good for their own families as well, and should be a great neighbor for you. So those were some of her learnings. For me, some of the things I took away from this conference is this iterative process, and really the need for listening and being able to pivot. And a perfect example of this is they had the St. Paul mayor wasn't able to come. He was doing some other great stuff. And so they had a community member come and speak. And she said, "Don't call my neighborhood disadvantaged. We are resilient. You know, please don't call us disadvantaged." And then there was a group of experts that came up next. And one of the experts continued to use the word disadvantaged neighborhood, our disadvantaged neighborhood, disadvantaged. And so I think it just reiterated for me the need to have a relationship with your community and continue to speak with them on their terms and know them. And I think this process could help you with that, but ultimately you need to be aware of building a relationship. And then what I saw with these eco districts that were there, they were successful because they had an engaged community. And the community was willing to take on action. They weren't just going to come to a meeting and tell you what solution they wanted, but they were invested in their neighborhood. They were willing to talk values, not just a solution of, I want a CVS on this corner instead of a five-story building. They were talking about the values they wanted, the future they wanted, and they were willing to put in time and energy to go beyond just a town hall meeting that you tell them what they want. Emily, I think I'm going to hand it over to you if you can unmute yourself and maybe share some of your learning.
Yes, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Well, I thought it was interesting. I appreciate the opportunity to go to the conference. It was the first conference like this that I had been able to attend. But the city is currently working on the comprehensive plan, like many other cities. And with the comp plan, the city of Edina is focusing on small areas that are likely areas of change or redevelopment within the city. And in those small area plans, all the working groups are looking at how they can implement eco district and eco district ideas into those small area plans, specifically two areas in town, being the Southdale area and the Grandview area of Edina. And so implementing ideas such as district energy, solar ideas, green buildings and sustainable buildings, EV ready. But I also, I learned a lot about the social equity that is involved in the EcoDistricts idea, so implementing that in the small area plans as well, which they're doing. I got to attend the rapid fire talks, and I thought that showed, and that was on the first day, and I thought that showed good examples of different of these EcoDistricts at different scales and different scenarios, and how they implemented those. I also got to sit through a presentation on games and community engagement, which I found very interesting. I thought it was they had different ideas to get people to participate, not just to participate, but to also see different ideas and perspectives through a different lens. So kind of role playing, and they had good three different examples of games that you could play and get people involved and excited, but not only with their idea or their viewpoint, but to also see things from a different viewpoint. So I got a lot out of that as well. But overall, I learned a lot, and I'm glad I had the opportunity to attend.
Great. Okay.
Thank you, Emily.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thanks, Emily. Any comments before we have hear from Joe from Limit? Okay, so Joe, you're on what is still the new Sustainability Commission in Bloomington?
Sure. Nice. Only a year and a half old. Or maybe not.
Year and a half. Okay, great.
I'll probably echo a lot of what Tara and Emily just said. The biggest sort of overall theme for me was to break out of the sort of environmental sustainability bubble that I'm usually focused on the Sustainability Commission, and see how it interacts with equity and resilience within the community. So the conference was, the very first speaker was Mayor Fry from Minneapolis, and he talked at length about how in Minneapolis, the environmental issues and the social justice issues are very intertwined, where they, you know, historically they redlined the Black community into the same places they put the polluting industries. And that was very intentional. And we don't have that exact problem in Bloomington, but we do have sort of a very clear like gradient of income increasing as you go west across the city, and all the stuff that you would sort of expect to go along with that. And then the very last speak of the conference was by Professor Edelman from Tufts University. And he had a lot of the same themes. One picture that I remember very clearly, he had a slide that showed a road in, it was a European city, I don't remember what, and then there was a road from, Houston or something. And it's, imagine growing up on this road where you have to cross six lanes of traffic to go anywhere as a child. You need a car to live here, cars are expensive, this is an equity issue. And then, the other road, there's green space, there's bikes, there's, a walkable community. And there is a big, it's tough to make that transformation for a lot of us are from suburbs, right? They're built 50 years ago with the expectation that you need a car to do everything. But I think that we can find a way to put, to slowly evolve away from that in some extent. There are also a lot of sort of one-off little presentations I went to with interesting technical stuff. So in Cleveland, I went to a presentation about the Metro Health Hospital in Cleveland is making an eco district. And that was sort of interesting. It's really just one business that owns this land. They're rebuilding their main facility. But at the same time, they have one of their organizational mandates is to improve the health of the community. And so they're taking a look at the surrounding area in Cleveland, which is not doing well economically, and trying to figure out, well, how can we use our renovation of this space to make more of a neighborhood level impact? And so they're just kind of starting. We'll see how successful they are with it. But it was interesting to me that they thought like that, and that hospitals and health organizations in general are going to have a risk, like they'll have in their organizational sort of goals, community impact, and so that's something that I think we can leverage as cities. Let's see. In Portland, there was a neighborhood or an eco district, I guess, where they are doing all the water stuff on site, all the way from black water to gray water to usable water. And so they've got a whole big system of various tanks that in rain gardens and stuff that it goes through, and it's all street level visible, or not street, it's there's sort of a pedestrian area in the middle of this neighborhood. And so, you know, you can see the big settling tanks, and they've got art around them. And there are these sunken gardens that are doing more water filtering. And that was real interesting, I guess, from a, you know, how do you deal with all this water perspective. I went to a presentation about the new Google Bayview campus for Google, and it's going to be a 2 million square foot building, just enormous. Wow. And they're doing geothermal heating and cooling for it. And the way they're doing it is, so this building is supported by concrete piles, like 80 foot concrete columns down into the ground. Like that's how these large types of buildings are supported. And so to save money, they're putting the geothermal loops in that concrete, in those concrete piles. Mm-hmm. And so I don't know, it was kind of a fun, yeah, nerdy dive into heating and cooling.
Well, I went to that one as well.
Okay.
And then someone said, well, we think the current building code here wouldn't allow for that. So I think it's interesting too to have experts in these conversations to then say, well, if we think this is a viable technology, how do we continue to educate those that make decisions on the state building code to allow some testing or something? So really looking at what are some of the barriers to allowing these technologies that will get us to our ultimate goals.
And there's quite a bit of discussion in that one about how this could be done in a cold climate. And so they had done all this modeling of like the temperatures and stuff. And they figured, well, they might need to have some supplemental cooling, but they're in San Francisco, they're not going to need extra heating. But if they did that same system in some place like Minneapolis, they would need another heat source. That's the other talk that I went to. There was a presentation about an EcoDistrict in Atlanta. So Atlanta has just created, they call it the Beltline, and it's a big bike path and green space circling the city. I mean, it's very large, maybe like a 15 or 20 mile radius of this thing that's going around Atlanta. And so this particular site, they're building some industrial office park kind of space to try and support local entrepreneurs. And it's being run by a family foundation. And so they had some interesting like financing models, and you know, usually this stuff would be driven by like a city or like a private developer, but here it was a family foundation charity that was trying to do this. So that was interesting. And I guess just to circle back on the environmental stuff tying in with all the social justice and equity, they talk a lot about how when you tie those together, you increase the number of people that are going to support what you're going to do. If we just kind of stay in our environmental lane, there are a lot of people that aren't really going to care too much about what we're doing. But if we bring in some of these other social factors, then we build more support for the things we want to do. So that's, I guess, my notes about the conference.
Joel, I was going to ask you, is any of this thinking being applied to the South Loop development?
Well, so that's interesting. So I got, you know, I went to this conference and I was all fired up. I'm like, all right, we got to meet with the Port Authority, who is in Bloomington. They're like the redevelopment organization. And so we met with them the next week and we talked about, you know, how can we start to integrate sustainability in general, environmental sustainability, and some of these things we talked about at EcoDistricts. And it's really just the start of the conversation. Bloomington is, you know, mostly developed, right? But there's one area sort of east of the Mall of America, south of the airport, called the South Loop, that is undergoing redevelopment right now. And so it's been a multi-year thing, and they're several years into it already. So I don't think they're going to be able to turn on a dime and do this stuff, but we're definitely going to be pushing more in that direction. You know, as an example, they did a district energy study when they started this in 2009, and they the study found like, well, it might be feasible to do this, the economics could work if things go well, but they weren't able to find a partner to take it on and be willing to build and run this facility. And that's, you know, a challenge, obviously. And when you have a site where there's nothing there yet, but there's going to be stuff there, it's a chicken and egg situation. You know, if somebody comes in and wants to build and run this district energy, they need to make sure that the buildings are going to be there. But if you wait for the buildings to be there, then it becomes too late to retrofit them with something like that. So it's a real challenge.
I mean, it's very challenging. I've gone to the planning meetings for the Ford site because that's where I grew up in St. Paul, okay, by there. And I've been quite interested in how they, I mean, that was filled with all kinds of controversy, but they were able to get the neighborhood input, you know, and input of a lot of people in these meetings. I went to planning meetings where there were 500, 600 people in an auditorium talking about the Ford, the Ford site, and then you know, kind of come up with a comprehensive plan. And I'd like to see, you know, whatever that could happen, you know, like that happen in South Loop. But, you know, other places in Bloomington, we have a lot of strip malls that are, you know, kind of hurting, you know, and these might be good pockets for that kind of development that you're talking about, you know.
Yeah.
Not as big as the South Loop, but pockets in neighborhoods where there's a big need for affordable housing.
Definitely.
Okay, well, thank you. Thank you, Joe. Yeah, I would just note that the closing speaker was Julian Agumon. I forget exactly from Tufts. His book,
Agumon.
His book, Just Sustainability, is really, I mean, it's cited so often, it's really a very thought-provoking, it's really an excellent sort of slice and view into the sort of the deep richness of social aspects of sustainability. So so it was a great closing and really
mentioned
it. Well, good. So moving to Rochester and Destination Medical Center in the city, Kevin, right?
Sure. So I don't really have any new thoughts to add. Going last is kind of painful that way. But
you can reiterate them and we may see them from a different perspective.
Sure, I can do that. I mean, I guess my major takeaway is kind of something that was already touched on, is the community engagement and stakeholder engagement strategies that these projects were undertaking were robust, were consistent, and thorough throughout the entire projects. Economic development projects in any of these areas are 5 to 10 years, maybe 20 years in the making. So having these plans in place were particularly important given the length of time that those projects are going to be undertaken. And ensuring that those systems are in place, both communication, but also bringing in those stakeholders throughout the process to ensure that they're continuing to give feedback as the projects continue over that timeline. So out of everything, I would say that was my biggest takeaway and probably most relevant to the work I'm doing in Rochester as well, with our own 20-year economic development project. I would say probably another close second would be when I look at the EcoDistricts protocol, the imperatives, but also the segments of resource regeneration, place, prosperity, connectivity, and so on. We have portions or are doing work in every one of those segments, but they're not stitched together. So the value of this protocol, I think, is coordinating all of those activities across what are really probably disparate projects within a city's view of, like, designing a public park with what we're doing now in Rochester, redesigning our transportation system for downtown. I see how they're connected, the community doesn't, which is a problem. And this protocol, I think, is one way that can help improve our communication, but also stakeholder engagement across what the public views as disparate projects, but are actually really quite connected. And we view them as connected, but sharing that in a more helpful and engaging the community in a more more effective manner would help those projects go forward more easily too, and be better projects ultimately. The three presentations, I guess, that stuck out to me, I was there for 3 days. So there is a research day even of people working on a specific eco district like projects in the Twin Cities came and presented on their district energy strategies and kind of the elements of, that they were taking from the eco district framework and applying to their work. So as they're on that day talking about what we're doing on kind of the sustainable design transportation aspects of the DMC project, we touched on the DMC district design guidelines a little bit as well. But what that is just a street redesign guideline effort for the geographic area of the DMC district, which is a 1 square mile area in the downtown city of Rochester. So what should the streets look like? How should the buildings interact with the streetscape so that we're actually creating a district and has a feel of a district and not, again, disparate development projects with their own identity as you walk down the street, which would be kind of a coroner's nightmare, I think. So that document tried to prevent that from happening. But the presentations I went to were really varied. The first one I went to was a community organization in Portland. Worked with a neighborhood. The neighborhood was interested in real estate investments. It was an underserved community. They said, we can only afford $10 to $100 worth of investment a month. We can't lose any money. What are our options? And this organization helped buy a strip mall building with in the downtown area of Portland, kind of just outside the city center, and then offered an investment opportunity to the nearby zip codes. So community members that were interested in investing in this real estate were paying down the mortgage of this organization and the bank over time, so they were becoming full owners of the building. What that did, though, is that it gave more chatter around what was going on within the community. The building was was full of occupants and businesses from the community it was serving, from the community owners. And then they were doing really well, all the businesses there, because the community had direct ownership over the building and its success. So the buzz was building among the owners, the tenants, but also the broader community of being patrons of the services being offered in that mall building. So I thought it was a pretty interesting example of Minnesota, like other places in the US, are really good at building strip malls. Like, what else could those be? Is there a way we can engage the community to build wealth and also engage more directly in the community in which they live? So they also talked about a housing component that was possible. But the whole part of that presentation was building a replicable model that they could translate elsewhere in the hopes that it would catch on and other communities would start to utilize it. So that was super interesting.
Where was that?
Portland, Oregon. The second was a process that Denver took to redesigning their affordable housing developments. And again, it really just focused on how they did their community engagement. So out of all of this, I had a similar question of like, help me understand what the process is that these projects are taking that are making them so effective from an engagement perspective. And this one, I think, really, really helps make that more concrete for me. The Redevelopment Housing Authority in Denver, they actually hired people to live within they're called community engagement associates or something like that. They lived in the affordable housing complexes. They held community meetings. And then also through this whole redesign process of the complex itself, constantly engaged the community to help them understand what was going on, what the budget was, what were the opportunities, how to engage them more fully and influence the design. And then throughout the entire construction process, let them know, all right, construction starting next month. This is what to expect. This is going to be painful. Those kinds of things. And even before that, went through a really intensive mapping exercise of understanding where crimes were occurring, where health disparities were occurring, those kinds of things to help influence the design as well. So I thought that was super translatable to really any city thinking about affordable housing, like a good model of what to work towards. And then the last one was equally different. But three public work directors from across the United States, one from San Francisco, another from Louisville, and a third from a private company actually that did some work in London, talking about their the amount of investment they're making in infrastructure over the next 5 or 10 years, billions of dollars of reinvestment in sewers, water pipes, wastewater treatment plants, those types of things, and ways that they are leveraging that investment to increase minority and women business owner engagement, but also community engagement. Kind of the direct example that I've been thinking about it even over the past couple of weeks, this one from San Francisco, where they have wastewater treatment plants directly adjacent to neighborhoods that are of lower value because they have this huge smokestack sitting next to them with huge tanks that are unsightly and those kinds of things. So they know they need to reinvest in that plant. They're investing billions of dollars to do so, and using that investment as a way to engage with the community, like, how can we make this better? And even putting their RFP, community engagement portion of their RFP review process, which is basically they're collecting money from contractors to help reinvest in the communities to win the bid. So one was a community center. The folks living in the community adjacent to this wastewater treatment plant wanted a community center, and the contractor bid or put forward a certain portion of money in order to make that community center happen for the neighborhood. They tried to do it previously. It didn't really work out because the community wasn't quite engaged, and they didn't end up with the facility where their needs weren't met. So that's kind of another crack at it to try to make this community-centered outcome more effective and a way to address environmental justice issues, right, that any city would face that sites any wastewater treatment plant anywhere of, you're probably not going to be able to move it, but you can improve it. And this was a good model of an incremental improvement for the community directly adjacent to it as well.
Yeah, you're spending so much money. Why not spend it on the margins a little bit better? And I mean,
yeah. And it was really simple from that presentation, really simple approaches to creating like pretty amazing community impact. So all their presentations are online too. Brionté can probably tell us where they're all located, but I would recommend checking those out if possible, because there's a lot of good information there over the course of the conference.
We will have all the presentations online. We'll have all the presentations online by the end of this week, and it's just summit.ecodistricts.org. So we'll make it really easy for you to find them from the homepage.
Awesome.
Great. Yeah, we'll put that on the front page of the GreenStep website so people can find.
But I guess the last thing I'll say, sorry, I'm taking up a long time.
No,
is that I see this just as a new way of doing business moving forward. Right? Like cities or any entity organization has been so isolated on achieving a certain task, building a certain building within a schedule. But this is just good practice of how do you effectively engage a community around a project that you're directly impacting and help that influence the project. How do you keep them informed and engaged and feel like they're part of this this process? I just as LEED was in the early 2000s, like, why are we specifying really unhealthy materials in our buildings and not paying attention to it? There are real impacts here. I see this as, why are we doing this effective project management for how we're implementing projects in cities? And why are we answering these questions effectively that the EcoDistricts framework is asking? So I think in my mind, it's kind of just the next iteration of, all right, we need to keep pushing, and this is a good framework to help keep pushing how to address equity through effective community engagement, stakeholder engagement strategies that also touch on sustainability. But I feel like that's what we had been focusing on as sustainability directors for the past 15, 20 years. And this is another way, another kind of arrow in our quiver to make our projects the best they can be.
Yeah, and when I think that's a great point, Kevin. And when I think about how to accomplish that, some of it is we're trying to figure out how do we build the relationship and how do we build this conversation to really speak to values, because I think so often we saw it in our own community. We heard transportation's an issue. We heard people wanted walkability and connectedness. So we started talking about this lid over the highway, a land bridge, much like Rondo. But when we talked to the community about here's our solution, instead of always starting with here's what we've heard from you, it's now to the point where people see the lid as more traffic when actually if planned right, it would be less traffic. And they see it as more cost, but actually being able to reline the sewer systems while we're building up this small district would be cheaper. So it's been fun in a way that now the community's not on board with it.
Oh, gosh.
And so we are looking at how do we use things like IAP2, which is a public participation, and how do we get conversations started around values rather than solutions. And a challenge to that too is getting leadership council on board, because there seems to be a tendency to someone talks to a council person and then they switch up the whole community engagement aspect. So I think how do we get all people involved in community engagement on the right process that can be effective and fruitful, and we're still finding challenges of how to deliver that and practice that. But that's what we're working on, and I'd love any kind of feedback or other ideas offline on that, but that's how we're trying to get to something like this.
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe we can just move into sort of general thoughts along this line of, so here we are in our cities. We maybe have a comp plan. We're working on a comp plan. We have small area plans, thinking of small area plans. We have development proposals being thrown to the city council. How does the EcoDistrict thinking, orientation, sort of values, how does it feel like it can work or not work, or what are the challenges? And maybe thinking about DMZ. So Destination Medical Center has all this extensive sort of planning and momentum and classic project management behind it. Does it feel like EcoDistrict, sort of what you learned, Kevin, can help infuse or shape or add on to what's happening anyway, because you're obviously moving down there?
That's a good question. I see it as like almost a process management tool, similar to what I think Brionté was sharing with us a little bit too, and I think it would be effective to help, as I kind of mentioned, stitch our transportation planning, our public park, public realm planning, the individual development projects that are happening on their own accord together within this 1 square mile area of downtown, to help make more sense, and also engage other people were talking around the DNC district. We have 6 different neighborhood organizations adjacent to our 1 square mile of the downtown area of Rochester. Public realm projects are site specific, so there's engagement needed for those specific areas around those specific projects. But then there's transportation planning that runs directly through all of those districts or community organizations, and they all need to be brought in, kept up to speed, understanding the project, and also ability to influence its design elements moving forward too. So I see this as a way to help one, me as a sustainability director, communicate all of the good things that are happening with the project, but also from an organizational perspective, communicate how all these things are connected as well, and the strategy behind bringing in different organizations for different projects and ensuring that we're meeting and touching all the people that we need to in order to make the projects as effective as they can be. I think the difficulty is that it's hard work to do that, and it takes a lot of tough questions of yourself throughout the process of who's here, who's not here, why aren't they here, were they not invited, should they have been invited, was that someone's mistake, was that not, those kinds of things. And I don't see it as like a moment in time that you're asking those questions. It's like it's a daily thing. So I almost think it's a practice of doing that, a diligence in doing that to make sure that you're engaging the people you need to throughout the entire project to make it as effective as it can. But the difficulty is, one, reminding yourself to do that, and two, committing to it to make it truly effective.
I have a question about that. I mean, maybe there's just promotional literature, but they were talking about 35,000 new jobs. Is that mm-hmm. Is that in the realm of possibility for this?
We're on track so far. So it's about, well, it's 30,000 is the target over 20 years. So we have, it's about 1,800 a year over 20 years. So we've actually exceeded that the past couple of years, but we're a little bit less than 2015. So 2015 is the official start date, but we're on track so far.
Well, unfortunately, I had an opportunity to meet about half of the medical staff at Mayo back in January. So I'm on a first name basis with about 100 of them. But, I always ask where they're from.
Yeah.
And where you're coming from. And they come all the way from Caledonia? I mean, it's really far off places. Is there any regional transportation plan that gets these people there? I mean, you know.
So Mayo has their transportation. They kind of have their own commuter transportation program. So they have shuttle buses that leave from the cities every day on an hourly basis. They have park and ride lots throughout regional communities as well to help shuttle people in, because there's 35,000 people that come to this 1 square mile in Rochester every day.
Really?
Yeah. So we have a really weird, I mean, it affects the transportation planning and everything else, but the amount that the density increases from the hourly work standpoint, 8 to 5 every day, is different than any other city in the United States. And we know that because of our transportation planning. So what do we need to be able to accommodate during certain hours of the day? It's a lot. Kind of the transition of, does Mayo need to be doing that? How does the city help complement that, especially as we're growing and want to bring more residents into Rochester over time?
Yeah, and then the adjacent counties. I mean, it seems to me that, I'm familiar with Cass and Manorville. Mm-hmm. And so, like, Cass and Manorville used to be a ghost town, and now it's booming, and it's like, so what's the difference? It's not because they started up a big business in Cass and Manorville. They're all commuting to, that Rochester. So what is the benefit of that county to provide, decent transit so not everybody has to drive there?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's more discussion kind of as we speak around regional transportation ties to the TNC transportation plan, as well as the city's transit network too. So how are all of these connecting, and what are our plans? How are the plans that we're moving forward with? How do they complement those regional networks, and how can they work together more effectively too? There's a significant park and ride strategy even for the city of Rochester to prevent cars from coming downtown. So we need regional transportation networks participating in that too, to help one ridership of our system.
As a quick addition to that, the city of Leroy actually established their own bus line. Specifically for their residents that are commuting into Rochester, and it was so successful that they've actually extended it down to a city on the Iowa border as one example of how a city is addressing that. As far as EcoDistricts go, I do have a question, and this might be one for Brionté. Is there a certain threshold where this becomes like an effective tool in terms of city size? We're always thinking about our little cities. What does this look like when you don't necessarily have the staff capacity to have, a sustainability director, or you don't have that type of dedicated capacity within the organization itself? And maybe little cities can't do this, but at what point does it become a viable option?
So that's a great question. I apologize because I wish I could give you a good answer. We have EcoDistricts in cities that are all like varying sizes, but they are a little bit on the larger end. As I'm running through the list in my head, we have, Seattle, Atlanta, Cleveland, Pittsburgh. So they all are pretty populous places. And so to primarily manage our communications and planning our annual summit, which is really just making sure people have the opportunity to convene. And we have three other folks who are on our program team who really dig in and do the work with projects. And they're the ones that sort of work with them to define what's a good fit and how to, what's the unique plan for implementation in each area. So they would have a better idea of knowing whether or not you have the right ingredients in your city to be able to pursue EcoDistricts certified. We do have a tool, it's called our readiness assessment, and I'm happy to share it with Phil afterwards. And so it's just a small worksheet, some questions to consider about your neighborhood, your district project, that helps you figure out if EcoDistricts is going to be a good fit for you. So I'd be happy to share that if you want to take a look at it. And if it's a good fit, then we'd be happy to get on the phone and help you work out how else you might be able to apply some of these things. So
So, and then Brionté, one of the towns that sort of presented was Millvale, Pennsylvania, which is sort of like a suburb of Pittsburgh, but it was pretty tiny, right? So how were they, I don't know how far down the eco district's path they went, but I know they talked a lot about the flooding stuff that they had dealt with.
Yeah, that's a really good point. Millvale isn't the city of Pittsburgh exactly, but it is nearby, but it is a much smaller town. And they're actually one of our strongest projects in terms of having real success and being able to engage the media and get the, you know, buy-in from the public and have the elected officials all on the same page. And they're doing a lot of really cool stuff in Millvale. So we consider them one of our stronger projects, and it is a smaller town, but because it's a suburb, I'm wondering if that might have some influence over where they're at.
You know, I was thinking about the project that I heard about it's in San Diego, but it's a small area of Pacific Beach. Yeah, Pacific Beach. So it's on the sort of north of the, what is it, SeaWorld, the Big Bay, northwest of downtown San Diego. And the person who presented, maybe an architect in practice, but I'm pretty sure that he said that his core team were volunteers. I think the effort was a storefront. Yeah.
That was one of the examples that I thought of there are multiple, but just mm-hmm. had a success in when the community really owned it and engaged mm-hmm. in the thing instead of just coming to a meeting, but really running the meeting and taking information from all parts of their community versus just maybe their one point of view.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and to this point of engagement over time. I mean, these development projects, as you were saying, Kevin, 5, 10, or the complexity, but the length of time and how to sustain that commitment. And I thought the people in Pacific Beach were in it for the long haul. So I'm thinking about short, visible. I mean, classic. You know, we need some quick sort of successes to sort of prove ourselves, show, engage people right away. And I think Pacific Beach with their volunteer staff was doing a really good job. So, but this readiness assessment sounds like a really helpful Brionté. So that'd be great. Yeah, if that's available, I could share that.
Sure, I'd be happy to share.
Brionté, do you ever do any kind of mentoring or networking connections? So I think of this over time and how you try to have the community own it. But how do you ever connect, like for example, San Diego with another community that's just getting started? Like they have someone to kind of go to and someone to kind of be their cheerleader as well that's been through it.
That's a really good question. We have a couple of convening activities we do. We have EcoDistricts certified calls where we bring all the projects together to sort of exchange information and lessons learned and, talk about challenges and figure out how they can sort of share what they're learning and share their progress and their successes. We also have this network of EcoDistricts accredited professionals. So these are people who take an individual certification for EcoDistricts so they can apply it in all the projects that they might be involved in. And they get together and they talk and share. But we don't have a process right now that exactly fits what you're describing, where we're connecting sort of existing EcoDistricts with other projects that are not in the EcoDistricts network so that they can have that kind of mentorship and shared learning. But I did write it down as a great idea for us to explore. But right now we mostly facilitate people who are sort of actively committed to the EcoDistricts project and connecting them.
So do you know if any of these EcoDistricts certified professionals overlap with any of the technical advisors for Green Subsidies or have connections where it would be like a handoff?
I'd say, Brionté, I don't think we have, do we have a accredited professional in Minnesota?
We do have EcoDistricts agencies in Minnesota. I can do a check of what we can probably work together, Phil, to do a cross check to see if there's anyone in the network already. Comparing our lists. Because I know for sure, like Stephen Klimek, who's with Towerside, is an EcoDistricts AP. And so we do have AP representation in the Twin Cities area and probably in the rest of the state, but I just have to check our list, cross-check our list.
Yeah, no, that would be great. That'd be a very tangible way for people to feel like, oh, there's someone here actually in Minnesota. In addition to you all, who are certainly very, very available, and obviously that for a project that registers. And actually, I was going to say compared to Star Community Index or really LEED ND, EcoDistrict certification is, I was going to say, much cheaper. I think that's accurate. I think you can spend tens of thousands of dollars certainly for, like, well, maybe for LEED ND, but for Star Community Index is also pretty expensive. So
I had a question kind of on this line around connections of there is a government alliance for race and equity.
Yeah.
I don't know what they're doing on a day-to-day basis, I guess, but I see some overlap between the mission of this with at least the mission of the sustainability directors sitting in the room or the coalitions that are here and kind of spoken so far, and an alignment with the EcoDistrict. So I don't know if there's a way to help bring some of these, again, disparate conversations together to say, like, we care about this stuff too. How can we work together and support your efforts? Or are there ways we can help improve the conversation or systems that they're coming up with to help, again, make a better outcome too? I think would be good if that's possible.
You know, yeah, I mean, Danielle can speak more to this, but yeah, GreenStep has met with the Government Alliance for Race Equity, and LMC has hosted a group of cities, and I don't know, Rochester, if anyone from Rochester has participated in sort of race equity discussion and planning, but Danielle, do you remember?
Off the top of my head, I don't recall if Rochester is a part of that cohort, but it's a nice connection to make, and it's something that we can think about moving forward. I know that we're actually looking at formulating resources for small cities, because here itself, that very specific program is pretty staff intensive. So we're looking at what those resources might look for small cities, as well as what those resources look like for existing cohort cities moving forward. And so as we develop that toolkit, this is certainly one thing that we can be considering, is the environmental aspect of it.
Yeah, there's a link in GreenStep. There's a link from, it would be best practice 24, sort of community engagement and indicators. There's a link to the GARE work that LMC has been, the LMC has a page for that Government Alliance on Race Equity. But it's true, you know, 10, 15 years ago, I think environmental justice issues or equity issues were sort of out there, and sustainability was really much more content focused and environmental focused. And I agree with EcoDistricts, in listening to you all and having been at the conference and sort of thinking about this, realizing how can we best, you know, walk out sort of better, more equitable developments, redevelopments, and I think EcoDistricts plays such a, it just gets our minds around it in a great way, and GARE is certainly a major nationally player in diving deep on city plans, actions, policies, procedures.
Yeah, anyone that has advice for me, we're going to actually, the city's going to have a race and equity coordinator as well, and so I've talked about how do we don't have that person yet, but how do we work closely together? Leadership kind of gets the overlap, but doesn't. So I'm trying to figure out the best way to articulate that, as well as I've approached sustainability in a triple bottom line, and there is a societal piece. People don't necessarily understand their equity, but I've approached it, build trust, because I come from it from a business perspective. Here's the business case of what I'm doing or why you should do it, and the equity really comes from a feeling standpoint. And so I'm also trying to think of how do we pair these to make them stronger together, but because we're coming at them from two different places, and I've built trust with colleagues in leadership, equity isn't in the same place, unfortunately, with parts of the community and parts of leadership because of the feeling, and they might have a feeling that is different. I'm trying to figure that out. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm going to have to tackle this next year.
Mm-hmm. Well, just like, I don't know, is it a diner or a St. Louis Park that hired a sort of a housing redevelop, a person to sort of.
We have that housing, affordable housing. And that's the person that came the first day when I couldn't.
Okay, yeah. I think these city staff positions, sort of equity, people focus on equity, affordable housing, or just the redevelopment of houses into bigger houses. I mean, all the conflict issues, the transaction time, lawsuits, all the costs that can impinge on a city. I think, frankly, we can make a business sort of city staff cost saving argument for having these talented persons working with, coordinating what happens on the city. So you don't have these things that blow up that can just eat up staff time.
Ultimately, a lot about what we talk about within GARE specifically is ultimately system improvement. It's not necessarily like a feeling, although certainly feelings are involved. So we could talk more offline about what that messaging really looks like, because I think there's a stronger business case to be made for that, particularly within local government, because we are the institutions that in many ways are we have the power over what those systems look like and how they affect our population.
Yeah, systems, processes, procedures, changing at that level so that we get better outcomes. Yeah, and a more harmonious, welcoming cities. I mean, that's certainly our goal. Just like 7 minutes to the end here. Any final comments about sort of viability of this approach in cities? Connecting up with existing?
I mean, I think what was just mentioned and kind of the GARE work is a big opportunity here for, I mean, if a city doesn't have an advocate now, like, where then, right? So I feel like they're in a disparate right now, like, initiative that we're not involved in. I think, I don't know, isn't necessarily aligning with this mission or objective, and I think it's important that it does. So how can we start pulling together the people, these different initiatives that are going on in the state, very sustainability or environmental focused with race and equity issues, to again create a better program and ensure that the people that are advocating for these things on a day-to-day basis have access to the tools that are being developed so that we can be more effective in our jobs too. But at least personally, it's not from like a lack of willingness, it's more a lack of awareness of how to be more effective. So that's something I would ask for and would help me out too.
Well put. Any questions from online or?
They've been listening attentively, but I haven't received any further thoughts or comments from online.
I think we still have that text box option.
Yep, for the webinar. I have the chat window up. And I suppose if anyone wants to unmute themselves to throw in a comment just verbally, I think we could manage that without, we might get a little feedback, honestly, but we might not too. So go ahead and give it a shot if anyone wants to. Otherwise, we have just a couple minutes left anyway.
Yeah, any final from the webinar or?
This is for a large scale development or redevelopment, clearly.
I think it can scale down. So could work for even a small city. But I think the bias has been larger. Scale develops just because you've got money in motion and enough of it.
So I think as a planner, you know, meeting all these statutory deadlines and pressures from developers, you know, trying to learn how to engage people or do the best we can in engaging the community. Very important, and this would help, but trying to meet all those deadlines, and it just seems challenging unless you're doing like a large scale project that might be city funded or state funded?
It, I mean, it, obviously with state or with city, I'm thinking about a project. I mean, often projects have some level of city participation, land, write down, taxes, staff, but it would have to be that way. But if the city is involved, the bigger the project, bigger the city, the more involvement makes it probably easier. But I think that example of Pacific Beach was, I don't know, I mean, they were all speaking of themselves as volunteering their time for this EcoDistrict work, which, and I think they had some very simple basic community development things like, you know, wayfinding in this Pacific Beach neighborhood. There were, but again, wayfinding from the point of view.
Was another one, how to improve walkability on the sidewalks. Like they weren't, that project specifically was not based around a development, but how can they make incremental changes in their neighborhood to address sustainability and equity issues through like simple sidewalk width. Or
yeah,
creating a car turnaround in the middle of a, instead of a stoplight, and asking for the city to try it out for a week or two. Like there are some pretty simple demonstrations they talked about of applying that.
So it wasn't a development proposal coming in, it was a neighborhood wanting to create a district.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, I see.
Put it more of a district feel to, yeah.
Yeah, that's a good clarification. There was not a developer or physical development project at all, I think.
Yeah, I agree. Really, the district was the process, right? Our community organizations meet, we talk about these things, these are the things we're focusing on, this is the timeline to help do those. But the things were district design stuff, not
helpful information.
Winter trip to San Diego. It's a
beautiful. I think that's on the calendar.
Don't you think they have a storefront along whatever that north south major road is? I'm thinking. See my mom in LA and
workshop in San Diego.
Yeah, don't you think? Winter? Did GreenStep do that? Would that be great? Well, we've reached our time here, 11 o'clock. Thank you all. Thank you all for making the effort to come, get here, check in online. And as I say, there'll be materials. We'll get out. I think last year we've been getting out. Just emailing people who were part of the webinar. So we'll have some materials that can help you follow up. And you all met Brionté. You know, there's a live, energetic, talented person who can help you with this going forward. So.
And I just want to take the time to say thank you all for hosting this. This is really, interesting to sit in and listen on. And I just took away a lot from this group on how we can sort of sharpen and provide access to more tools that we have to help overcome some of the challenge that we've heard, or to help clarify how EcoDistricts protocol could be useful for you, even if you're not centered around a development project or you don't have a lot of capacity or, you know, like paid support for it. So I can certainly sharpen all of that, but I just want to say thanks for helping provide that clarity, and I will work to provide it for you.
Thanks,
Brianna. Thank you. All right. Well, thanks, everyone. Grab bagels, please. Take home. This is your early lunch here. Grab a cup of coffee. There are some cups. Yeah. So, and have a good rest of the day.